Well, you know, there's a little bit that I'm going to be kind of sharing and like co-facilitating with Pam today, but really I love how Pam labeled this segment on burnout as being dangerously tired. And it actually reminds me of so I used to work at a nonprofit that was like actually pretty similar in a program, pretty similar to GRIP. And when it comes to like my own experience of burnout, I would say this actually is like very near and dear to both of our hearts, because I think we both like dramatically experienced a weariness that's like really debilitating towards our work. So when I was at this other position for a few years, it was honestly like a boundaryless trauma therapist on wheels. I was their banker. I was watched their kids. I was their mom. Talk about attachment last week. Really kind of a parental figure. I think that this topic had me rethinking through that time in my life. And again, I love this as dangerously tired, because it landed with me driving to IKEA 2 days before Christmas to pick up an art easel for my sister to give to her kids in Wisconsin. And I got so in my head around this one client and was so tired that as I took that exit, I'm staring straight out the window. And my burnout was so severe. I really do think it was probably burnout and tiredness. I smacked right into the back of a different car, and it was a 4-car pileup. And I'm really embarrassed to share that story, actually, because it's like, oh, that's like not very great. But I think that if we take this thing and sit in our weariness too long and don't heal it or pay attention to it, it will end up in some situation like that. Maybe not totally in your car. I love that car, honestly, but she gone. She's gone. So I think that, you know, a lot of what that looked like for me was my sleep was impacted. Either I couldn't fall asleep or I'd wake up early. I was always in my head instead of in my heart, especially around connecting with the students. And there just started to be this pervasiveness and like a lot of anxiety, a lot of depression. And honestly, from that moment that I crashed that car, it took me 6 months to actually really do something about this thing that I had started to notice within me. And at that point in time, I think the only thing that I could, you know, we make the best decisions we know how to at the time that we make them, I think. I turned in my 6-week notice. I didn't have another job after that, and I ended up in Logan Square in a 6x6 burnt orange red room with a twin mattress on the floor, just trying to be like, how do I actually come back from being so depleted? And, you know, we just, like, I want to share that. Pam and I wanted to share some of our own personal stories up front. Just to be like, I think that there is something to this, especially in the environments that you guys are working in, where the need is so huge. And it's like, well, if I don't meet the need, and also this is what I'm paid to do, then how do I actually take care of myself to where like my cup can actually be full or refilled over and over and over again so I can pour out on my students? So that's a little bit of like my own story. And then I think that, like Pam will share some of hers as we kind of move along, but just to say that like this is a real thing, and it's actually dangerous in some ways to not tune in and take care of ourselves. So
yeah, thanks Alex for sharing your story. And like she said, I will share a little bit of my story as we're going along. And I would just echo what she said, that I am really excited and grateful to be with you today. This is especially a topic that is close to my heart, and I think particularly to provide to helpers like yourself who are providing support to other people. And so I want to share with you where we're headed to today. So for any of you who heard Alex's story and maybe it resonated with you, or maybe you're thinking about your mentors and you're thinking, oh man, that kind of sounds like what Alex was talking about, we're going to answer the question, is this me? The other thing that we're going to look at is, what are the things that contribute to our sense of weariness and tiredness? We're going to define different types of weariness. So there's different words that kind of have flown throughout kind of the psychology world. And then we're actually going to skip number 3 and go to number 4, which is giving you practical tips on how to get the rest that you need. Because I think, from what I've heard from Alex, that we're all experiencing some level of weariness and tiredness. So we're gonna start off actually with doing some self-reflection that's going to require some group participation. And typically when I meet with my clients for the first time, I ask them to start noticing what is going on in their body, in their emotions, and in their lives that lets them know something may be amiss. And so this question, as I'm about to ask it to you guys, I want you to consider, how do I notice it in my body, in my emotions, and in my life in general? So the question is this: how do you even know that you're tired?
It'd be great to hear from you guys. Yeah. How do you start to know? What do you start to pick up on? Sleepy. Yeah, that's like a big one.
Totally.
Way to go for the obvious. It's like Jesus in Sunday school class. Were you going to say something, Brooke?
I get like frustrated. Or, like,
irritable. Frustrated. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Always kind of on the edge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can zone out a little bit.
Zone out. Yeah. That's a little bit of me in my car, staring out the window, zoned out. Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah.
I literally have a hard time finding words.
Yeah.
Caught up in my thinking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, more isolated maybe, even. Yeah, more internal, more isolated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, headaches.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how does this start to show up in your body? Mm-hmm. I appreciate that, headaches.
We carry a lot of our stress, and you guys did the emotional literacy mm-hmm. a couple of trainings ago, but you carry a lot of our stress in that top part of our body, so it's not surprising to hear then that there's headaches. Mm-hmm. Yep. And also in our belly.
Yeah.
I've spoken to a lot of people who talk about indigestion kind of issues as a result of weariness, tiredness, anxiety.
Mm-hmm. So here's, do we actually have on your, because mm-hmm. it's one thing to kind of like name some of these things that we start to notice, but mm-hmm. there is a, I mean, we called it weary bingo. And I don't know if we'll actually play.
I think we should play.
Okay, we'll play bingo. I'm actually going to grab a copy of it because Pam's going to call him out. Yeah, let me grab this. You can call him out.
So what I'd like you to do is take just 1 or 2 minutes to read through here. And what I'd like you to think about is today, on this day, July 9th, do I connect with any of these here? And if you get 3 or 4 in a row, I would love for you to yell bingo.
Got it.
Okay.
Yes.
So go for it.
There you go. It's kind of a sad way to acknowledge our weary, but with a little bit of humor.
Supposed to be circling some?
You know, Corel, yeah.
Circling or checking off.
Oh. Yeah. What am I supposed to be taking off?
Here you go. You want a pen?
The ones you resonate with.
Oh, no, I have one.
Oh, good.
Oh, the ones I resonate with.
Uh-huh. Let's just assume all of them apply to you.
That is true, though. They all apply, so do I win?
You, in some ways, win. In some ways, you lose. You know, personally, I would say also throughout my day, I feel maybe around 3 o'clock a majority of these, mm-hmm. you know, on like a daily level. Mm-hmm. So I resonate personally with a lot of them.
Yep.
You know, as you're kind of finishing that up, I am curious for you guys to notice, like, even as you're circling these different things that honestly highlight a deficit. Mm-hmm. What is going on in you and what is kind of landing mm-hmm. Within you guys?
Wait, is that a question to answer?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
I got a bingo and...
Woohoo, bingo! Thanks for being the first one, Brooke.
Should have brought candy or something.
What was your question? What's resonating as we do this?
Yeah, what is kind of like landing within you? What's resonating? What's kind of coming up for you, even as you circle?
I feel great that these are related to being tired. And like bigger, broader, like I became a mean person permanently.
I really appreciate that because it's kind of fixable in some ways. Mm-hmm. Like just because you resonate with a lot of these doesn't mean you're at the end of, it doesn't mean you're never coming back. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
gonna say sad because I feel like, is this ever changing?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. There is a sadness to it because it kind of like starts to acknowledge some of that own, like our own personal needs and realizing, oh, these aren't actually being met. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes when, if I do things like this, I get a little overwhelmed that I try to hold hope, but it's like, ooh, right now it feels like I'm in the pit mm-hmm. in some ways. You know, the reason that we actually did this is so you can start to reflect on an individual level mm-hmm. about what's going on within you. And then, you know, we've already kind of talked through. Will you go through?
What do you want to go to?
The next one. Because we kind of already covered this when they say like personally. Is there anything you want to add?
Share.
Yeah. Okay. Pam's gonna share something. Just kidding.
So I think I want to reflect a little bit on what you said about feeling angry. I think that in my time of working in community mental health, I found myself getting angry. Particularly around my finances. Like I could tell that I was starting to get weary and drained when my bank account was low and I didn't see it coming. You know, community mental health, you're not gonna make a whole lot of money anyways, but I think it shocked me and it made me mad and it made me resentful that like here I was deciding to work with this population, really believing in it, but feeling like I wasn't getting my needs met by working in the field. And so I definitely resonate with the sense of resentment. And I think also the sadness that comes from weariness. So my story, I just wanted to share. So I used to be a part of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, and I was a mentor of students, college students, and I was taking my first vacation. And that is a position where you, again, don't make a whole lot of money, but it's all about kind of your internal growth and sense of who you are becoming by being in a leadership position. And I decided I'm gonna eat a McDonald's breakfast sandwich. And I think it was the McGriddle, right? The one with the sausage, it's with the sweet. Like mm-hmm. pancake patty and syrup. Oh my goodness. I still love it now.
They serve that one all day, I'll be
there. Yeah, they do serve it all day, although I do believe that McDonald's is one of those things where you should only eat it when you're treating yourself or when you're hungry. Those are the times when I feel most thrilled about eating it. So anyways, I'm sitting here eating this McDonald's breakfast sandwich and I start crying. And it's not the like joyful tears, although I love food, and so don't put it past me that I wouldn't cry about eating something that I love. But I was crying because I was realizing, oh my goodness, I have permission to take care of myself right now. And maybe McDonald's breakfast sandwich wasn't the best choice for taking care of myself, but the reality is I had permission to rest. And I think the other thing that I noticed from that experience, or just kind of the question that came to mind for me, is I wanted to know, how did I get here? How did I get to the point where eating a McDonald's breakfast sandwich brought me to tears? And so I did a lot of reading of different books. This one actually came to mind. This one's actually more new. But it's written by this pastor and this author called Carrie Newhoff, and I'll pass it around. And it's called Didn't See It Coming. And it's basically seven categories or things that happen in a leader's life that people don't expect, but that most people experience. And so he talks a lot about burnout and weariness. So we're gonna shift now to talk about
So thinking about it, you know, a lot of where we just spent was kind of what's going on personally, internally, but we want to think like what is actually contributing as a whole, you know, to kind of take like a little bit more of like a skies up view. So what actually do you think, both personally, but then also just in general, and you know, we put some of these things up here just to kind of like prompt, but what in real life is actually contributing and adding kind of even from a whole level to this thing we call burnout?
And I think that culturally, we're in a culture that is always adding and never taking away. Mm-hmm. And people end up being like human doings instead of human beings in a lot of ways. That I'm just in like do. But like that actually is, it takes away, I think, some of this like humanness in life. Mm-hmm. So I think that actually like our culture is a big one, that we reward people who work and we like esteem people who work. And, you know, I remember when I switched into opening a private practice, there was a lot of pushback in the sense that I was trying to shape my life to be more restful. And that is not the norm. I actually received a lot of shame thrown at me. You know, a lot of shade was thrown around like, no, of course you should be working 60 hours a week or something like that. I can't remember the details, but it's like there, our culture and like all this stuff added on top. And like, I appreciate what you said too, Karel, about the sense of responsibility. Well, I'm trying to be, I think even when we add our faith piece, I'm trying to do good and be someone who's interacting with the kingdom and like impacting people's lives. And there ends up being this like heaviness that we carry. You know, I think that, I think I was saying this last week too, but that phrase that like any type of pain that's really left in isolation, that I pull back with it and I kind of sit in here with it, any type of pain that's left in isolation will always land in a sense of shame. It is my fault. I should have been able to do better. There's something wrong with me. So that's why I think sometimes like not engaging with it ends up landing in a place of like shame that, you know, there's a book, it's called The Soul of Shame, and he comes at the fact that actually shame is like one of Satan's like greatest tools because it really debilitates the creativity that like God has given us to continue to do things in life and in his kingdom, and it really kind of like cuts the legs out from that. So anytime it's like, oh, isolation in some ways is working for me right now, but when is it not working anymore because it lands in a sense of like shame that compounds my weariness? You know, before maybe we move to the next slide, I think I was thinking about this morning that also, because all you guys are in some ways like leaders, and where too is like policy and organizational structure, where are these things as like leaders that it's like, oh, this is actually adding more of a burden to the people that, because policy is supposed to be serving people, but when does a systemic, you know, how is this thing like both internal, how is it relational, how is it then like in a community, and then how is it also like systemic in some ways? So I think too, like, not to like put a burden, but as a leader, so start to think through, gosh, are there things that I could be doing that would actually shape this for the people around me to start to shape some of that cultural piece?
Yeah, I think systemically, especially, again, with community mental health, there's this expectation that you have to meet so many people within the day and still get paperwork done. And kind of that expectation was decided by Medicaid, but then that's a lot of pressure, right? And it doesn't give as much room for the staff to take the breaks that they need to get the rest that they desire. And so I think, yeah, I think systems can influence that.
Right. And the reason, you know, we're going to kind of move on into also like, what can you start to do personally to take care of some of this stuff? So we'll continue to move on at that level, but to keep in mind that it's like, it isn't just this lower level. It's also, it's different levels, you know, and that in of itself can feel like a burden, but that I think sometimes to start doing the lower level, the personal level, does continue to flow. It's more grassroots. But then if you are a leader, to also start to think through, how do we top down start to take care of some of these things? How do we shape a culture in some ways?
So this next slide looks similar to the last one. However, I do want to reflect on just these burdens that we carry, that we experience, that shape then the type of boundaries that we put in place when we're working with our mentors, our clients, the kids that you guys get to engage with. And so just a couple of the boundaries that I want to focus on is the family boundaries. So I think you shared, and I had that experience of moving back home after my internship with InterVarsity, and there was a struggle of like, when do I have time to spend with my friends, but also I want to be responsible and grateful to have a place to live because I didn't have anywhere else to live. That is a lot. And so certain families struggle a little bit more with how they set up their boundaries. So you guys have probably heard this language before, but there's folks who struggle more with enmeshment. And that's basically families where they have a lack of boundaries. There's a lack of independence, a lack of autonomy. I'm seeing some nodding of heads. So you guys have seen that and you know that, right? And then on the other side is families who disengage. So those who are overly disconnected, they're rigid with their boundaries. Someone might get married and the sibling doesn't know about it. The reality is our family boundaries, we can start to see the way that those impact the way that we work. And so an example of that would be if I'm living in a family that struggles with enmeshment, maybe I am the person who wants to give the clothes that I can't fit to the kids that I'm mentoring. Maybe I'm the person who is answering the phone all the time, late at night. I'm Facebook friends with my mentee. I'm going to all of their family holidays and they're inviting me to, or I'm inviting them to mine. That's kind of where enmeshment can play its part in the way that we engage with the folks that we work with. Have you guys ever seen anyone who struggles more with the disengagement? What does that look like in terms of work?
I think to give a picture of it, if you have like on a continuum, you have enmeshment over here, and it's like where two individuals become so discombobulated that it's like, where does one begin and the other end? Mm-hmm. That there is no boundaries at all. Mm-hmm. And then you have like, okay, I'm going to be hyper independent. And then it shows up and like, oh, it's actually hard to work with this person. It's hard to be in relationship because where are they? Where do they go? They're like way away. And I think that when we start to talk about boundaries, we start to think about how do I actually both be myself and be with? That we can be close, and that boundaries are really setting up a long, it's like me being like, I am interested in having a long-term relationship with you where I don't get so tired that I have to quit this relationship. Yes. So me enforcing a boundary allows me to both be with and self, like, and an individual together.
Yep.
So just to highlight too, pressure of being a secure attachment for others. I put that on there after just our conversation last week, that there's this sense of like, oh, I'm trying to like be a good thing in relationship. So
I think the other thing that we wanted to point out, you guys were talking already about cultural, but also I don't know if a lot of the mentors that you work with are in the millennial age right now. Okay, majority of them, right? Yeah. So they would probably say, and I could say from my own experience in the young 20s, that there was a lot of pressure at that age. I felt a lot of pressure to fight for injustices, to stand up for multi-ethnicity. And I think for millennials now, they have access to all of this news and what's going on with the world right now that I did not have access to. Like, internet was a thing, but not the same. Yeah. And so it is overwhelming. There's overstimulation. And then there's a pressure to how do I respond to this? So the next thing I have is a video.
If you click escape, it should be queued up there, the Internet Explorer at the bottom. Brené Brown. Yeah. She my sister. Yeah. She my best friend. I call her Brené by first name basis. She doesn't know I stalk her.
Have you met her before yet?
Never. No, I'll never. Let's be honest.
Okay.
She's a global phenomenon. She will not meet a plebeian.
So let me let me set up Brené Brown's.
That's recorded. I'm sending it.
So let me set up this video about Brené Brown. So sounds like y'all know who she is. Yep, very familiar. Feisty woman, psychologist, researcher, talks a lot about vulnerability. And I like to say vulnerability is the ability to be able to connect with others in a healthy way or in a authentic way. And so she, at this point in the video, is talking about the myths or the things that we believe that keep us from being vulnerable. And so the first one of these myths that we're going to look at is being vulnerable means that I have to trust everybody and that I have to share everything. So we'll see if this works.
Oh, you know what? It might have bumped back to the end.
Yep.
We're taking it out.
Oh, no, we're good.
We could actually help predict when it's okay to be vulnerable with other people. And I was like, the minute it becomes comfortable, it's no longer vulnerability. Call it whatever you want, but don't use that name on your app.
Okay, so here's the point.
Trust comes before vulnerability. This is a hard one, right? Like, do I trust you, then I'm vulnerable with you? Or am I vulnerable with you, and then I learn to trust you? And the answer is yes and. It's a slow stacking over time of vulnerability and trust. We don't go out with, like, you know, the big guns and, like, nice to meet you, I'm Brene, here's my darkest secret. Can I trust you forever?
We've all known people like that.
We start with little things, mm-hmm. and we build over time. And the more I share with you, and the more you honor that sharing. But here's the thing. You share with people who earn the right to hear your story. Your story is a privilege to hear. You share it with people who earn the right to hear it. You don't share it just because. Vulnerability minus boundaries, not vulnerability.
So that last line, I love. Vulnerability without boundaries is not vulnerability.
One of my favorite psychologists is Eric Erickson. He has a stage model that stacks on top. You know, it's like trust first, mistrust, of it, and you go through all these stages. And there is one that's identity versus role confusion. And the thing I like about his model is what you do in one stage actually impacts what you do in the next stage, and it builds on top of each other. So if you don't know who you are, you actually can't share yourself with somebody in a true way. So maybe, I like what you said, it might be something else. Like, I don't know what that is, but it's something else. Is you're actually not truly sharing yourself with that person. And then, like, what stacks on top of that is intimacy versus isolation. That really, If you do vulnerability without boundaries and you're not really sharing who you are, then actually you end up in an isolated place and you don't end up in a place of intimacy.
Mm-hmm. Again, that I think that would lead to a sense of resentment. And so I think the point of sharing that outside of vulnerability does not equal vulnerability. If we think about mentoring without boundaries is not mentoring. Right? If we don't set some boundaries with the kids that we're working with the staff that we work with, then we are not modeling what it looks like to provide limitations mm-hmm. and to acknowledge our own limitations.
And modeling is the key way that anybody learns anything, ourselves included.
Totally. So you guys have a permission to rest. We're going to go quickly over defining the different types of the different types of weariness, and then we'll get into some of the practical tips. So burnout, can someone read that definition there for me?
Burnout, associated with stress and hassles involved in your work. It is very cumulative. Is relatively predictable and frequently a vacation or change of job. Helps a great deal.
Mm. Yep. So you've probably heard of burnout before. The one thing that I want to say that's different than some of the other terms that we're going to talk about is that burnout is based primarily on your work function. So the things that kind of make you overwhelmed that you have to do to day to day. So maybe it's that the copier machine, every day I have to fix it, and that is becoming a pain. What are some other ones that you think would kind of connect more with you guys' experience?
Can I share one?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I used to work for this grant that only allowed us to get original signatures in blue ink, And in my role, I served all of DuPage County. So you can imagine that it's honestly unimaginable. I think it's such a waste of resources. I would drive a half hour with an original document to get one signature, drive somewhere else, grab another signature just to come back and drive mm-hmm. to their actual office and drop off that form. And that, like, stress and hassle involved in your work, mm-hmm. I don't understand that. still.
Going to the next one, which is compassion fatigue. Can someone read that one?
Please, I cannot be accessible 24/7.
The emotional residue of exposure to working with those who are suffering, particularly those suffering from the consequences of traumatic events.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the folks you work with are not strangers to trauma, right? And you guys are experiencing it and seeing it with them probably on a daily basis. And I like that they call it compassion fatigue because compassion means to suffer with. Mm-hmm. And so this is a weariness, a drain that comes from hearing the personal stories and walking alongside the person through those struggles.
That residue, that stickiness, you think of like, I really appreciate sometimes words that give a texture. Mm-hmm. So you think of like, oh, I have heard somebody, an atrocity in someone's life that lingers with me and feels almost like, if you're cooking, you ever get something like an oil or a grease,
yeah.
And it's just like, oh, this, like, I've even like washed my hands and there's still a little bit of something, or on the pan, there's still, mm-hmm. I think that hearing trauma or being in the suffering of people's lives leaves the stickiness that actually we could be off hours. We could be somewhere else. I could be driving to IKEA and mm-hmm. guess who I'm thinking about? I'm thinking about this one particular girl mm-hmm. and something really difficult that's going on in her life. Boom, crash my car.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this, it continues to linger with us.
Mm-hmm.
Was there anything else you wanted to say?
Mm-mm.
So here's where it gets really tricky, and we won't linger very long on this slide, but your interactions with people who experience trauma can actually compound if the intensity and the duration that you're experiencing them, and you can end up with a PTSD diagnosis. It's called vicarious trauma, that this interaction and not taking care of it could potentially actually overwhelm our own capacity mm-hmm. to deal with what people are experiencing in life to the point that it actually registers as a trauma within your own body.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So so this is really important.
Mm-hmm.
And I think as anybody who's in the helping profession, would mm-hmm. you know, we're in the helping profession as counselors. I think pastors are in the helping profession. All mm-hmm. of you guys. That's what you are, your helpers. How do we come alongside and help people in their lives?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of literature out there that's like, there's now starting to be this thing called vicarious trauma, that I actually register a trauma within me because of something that you experienced.
Mm-hmm.
I think that these are the large categories for a PTSD diagnosis. I include those there. Maybe you can like work through some of them on your own time, mm-hmm. but to start to interpret what are these large categories, as I start to work through the category of like what it actually means to land with a PTSD diagnosis, mm-hmm. We have to go through some of these different things.
Mm-hmm.
That's not all inclusive, but they're here just for your point of reference.
Mm-hmm. One of the staff that I used to work with, he unfortunately, we did a lot of work inside people's homes, and he went to go visit one of our clients who we hadn't seen for a while, and it turned out the person had passed away. And he walked in seeing that person's body. And so afterwards, mm-hmm. he experienced a lot of these symptoms, right? So flashbacks, nightmares. He would get really anxious when he thought about having to go see a client that we hadn't seen for a while, because he was mm-hmm. worried that he would walk into a similar experience. So that was him visually seeing something that was traumatic, but that doesn't have to be the only type of way that we experience trauma, right? Again, we're talking about what are the things that you hear, what are the things that you walk through with your students that can lead you to experiencing vicarious trauma.
And maybe just the last thing to say is mm-hmm. the reason that we include all those three categories is because where does maybe an irritability in the functions of your job wear you down? That then you stack on top of it, compassion fatigue, this residue and the stickiness that your kind of your emotional immunity, mm-hmm. immune response is actually lowered,
mm-hmm.
and then that it would actually compound to vicarious trauma. Mm-hmm. So to kind of like realize that there's all these different categories that stack on top of each other.
Mm-hmm. So we want to get you to a point where you get to see what does it look like to be in a season of rest. So that it doesn't get to a point of vicarious trauma, or if you find yourself already there, what are the things that you can do to help yourself? So the first thing is to cease from working, and that is kind of what it sounds like. So ceasing from your work here, I know that might be tricky in terms of staffing issues.
I was thinking financially too.
Yeah, financially, what you're able to do. If you cannot cease from working, I would say that anything that brings a level of burden, pressure, responsibility is something that you say, I need to take a break.
Even like vacation, I think, was something you mentioned to me when we were walking through it. How do I tune out for even a little bit of time? Or do I have a rhythm of, there's some type I have in like a week, there's some type I have in a month, there's some longer time that I have in like maybe a year, that we are like putting these rhythms of rest in, like in our practice.
And if people are interested in knowing more about rhythms of rest, there's a book called Sacred Rhythms by Ruth Haley Barton. And she goes through spiritual practices or rhythms of rest. And that is actually the book that I read once I realized that I was burnt out from InterVarsity. It was really a really good book to read. So the next step is to reconnect with your longings, desires, and passions. So it is true that when we are more wearied and tired, that we the things that we enjoy doing are the first things that come off of our to-do list, right? But it is actually those things that are going to bring restoration. So what are some things that you guys feel passionate about doing, that you love doing?
That maybe has hit the back burner too, maybe specifically.
Being outside in nature, hiking.
Good luck in Chicago, Sean.
Oh, you're in the wrong city for that.
Acting, singing, like performing, not ministering, but just performing brings a lot of
play.
Yeah, play.
The next one is practicing self-care. And I know that that is kind of a fad word right now, self-care. But I do think that what are the things that let us know I am offering compassion to myself, that I am turning towards myself? One thing that I have talked to some of my clients about, especially if they struggle with self-compassion, is I'll say, where do you feel the anxiety in your body? And they'll say, oh, I feel my heart. And then I'll say, well, why don't you put your hand on your heart right now? And take a couple of breaths. And it's kind of this physical touch that we do towards ourselves that lets us know you are cared for, or I'll have them hug themselves. So there is something powerful, I think, about turning towards ourselves and saying, I'm going to care for my body and my emotions.
And embodying it. If our minds and our bodies are so interconnected, how do you actually embody it?
Don't do this in isolation. So has anyone heard of Morgan Harper Nichols? I love her. Yeah, I like just discovered her. I was listening to a podcast. She is actually the sister of Jamie Grace. I think she's older than her, right? Okay. So Jamie Grace is a Christian artist, and Morgan Harper Nichols, she's done a lot of things. So she sings, she writes poems, and the poems are connected to people's stories. And I just find that that is really powerful. And so I love this poem where she says, tell the story of the mountain you climbed. Your words could become a page in someone else's survival guide. And so how powerful is it that when we say, this is what I'm struggling with, how that can actually build connection and a sense of validation and normalcy for other people who may be struggling with the same thing.
It gives permission, it models and gives permission. And think about the Me Too movement, that when I turn and say about a difficulty I've been in, that someone else can say, oh my gosh, me too. You know, that you don't have to do that in isolation.
And then grieve your losses. And Carrie Newhoff talks a lot about that. He says, if you don't grieve your losses during this time of rest and recovery, you're missing tremendous opportunities to put the past behind you. There's so many clients that I work with who will often say, I just want to let go. I'm noticing this woundedness come up within me again, and I don't want to have the same reaction anymore. And so we grieve our losses. We do that by talking to our friends, by talking to community, by talking to counselors, by finding rituals and ways of letting go. And I think first acknowledging where that woundedness is coming from. And then lastly, and I love this one, is don't put your clothes back on. So I was talking with a client and she shared the best advice that she ever received when she first became a mom was when she got home from the hospital from delivering to wait a few days to put your clothes on. Because once you put your clothes on, people think that you're okay. And so what would it look like in this season of rest to not put your clothes on?
To kind of embody, you know, like, obviously we don't want you walking around with us, but like, but you know, I used to, you know, when I was in grad school and I went to a grad school that was like, everybody dressed to the nines. I was like, what is up with you people? I was like, it's college. I'm like, you should show up in your sweatpants to class. But everybody would dress to the nines, but I was kind of rebelling against that in some ways. And I would show up, you know, ball cap on, in like a sweatshirt, in my sweatpants, and people would go, are you okay? Are you not feeling well? But in some ways, I think if you're actually at a depleted state, maybe it's not actually about your clothes, it's more of a state of attitude that's like, I'm not okay, and I'm okay with not being okay, and you can, I want you to acknowledge that I'm not okay, and we don't have to really fix it, but stop trying to present as something that you're not in some ways. So, yeah. You know, just to kind of, I think, wrap it up, I think that even as I'm sitting here listening and thinking about my own weariness, you know, even as I share with you guys that first time, I'm taking a break from seeing clients, you know. I've got some own weariness that I'm, like, dealing with in some ways. And I read through a list like that, and I'm like, oh, gosh, a bunch of to-dos to add to the burden of trying to take care of myself. How do I actually do that? And I think the biggest one, even thinking through that pain left in isolation, leads to shame. I think if you could pick one, it's to not be in isolation around it. To get somebody in partnership and collaboration around bringing you back to health. And also it's like, out of all the resources out there, pick one. If you can't implement all of them, pick one and start to do this thing that's like, that's healing. And even I love that, like when you shared all the things, I feel like what landed in me is like overwhelm. And when you shared sadness, that it's like when I actually, thinking back to even our first conversation, when I tune into my emotions, they're actually trying to tell me something. And that second point on the out of the six, that it's like longing, desire, there's something that has actually left your life and that maybe your emotional responses is trying to tune you in to these things that are missing. That what is my sadness actually trying to tell me about the way my life is right now? And maybe it's like a grief. Life is not as it should be. You know, you're overwhelmed and like trying, you know, this is a conjecture I'm putting word, you didn't say this, but like, I'm trying to show up in everything in the best I can be for like my family, for the mentors and mentees, for all these different people. And like, I want to be good. I want to be the best in some ways, but actually to tune into our emotions helps in this process of healing from burnout because it is a guide in some ways. What's some of your guys's, you know, as we kind of wrap up here in the next few minutes, is there any lingering thoughts, questions, comments, anything that's like, as we clean the beach, I like to say, what actually needs to be said before we wrap up here?
Just if you guys have any practicals on, so with vicarious trauma or hearing heavy stories, like how, what is best to process, like as we're hearing stories or...
You know, I think back to that first time when we talked about emotional regulation, that deep breathing, movement, mantra in some ways, or that self-talk is how do I regularly tune in to myself in that way to actually keep a system instead of spinning up in anxiety and hypervigilance and getting stuck there, which brings down your immune system or like sitting in like numbed out, isolated depression in some ways is how do we continue to actually emotionally regulate in a way that maintains health. So I think that like really simple things like deep breathing and movement as a way to connect and care for your body. But also, you know, a lot of when you look at trauma work, you know, it is, I think that anytime you can kind of attach to your creative expressive side, whether that's writing for you or music or painting and drawing or even just speaking it, I think that when we speak, it's a creative process. That when I can connect to where trauma has often lodged in our brain in the right side, which thinks very picture-like or in a creative way, that as a processing tool. But the biggest thing, you know, Viktor Frankl, I haven't read all of his works, but he was in a Nazi concentration camp, and he found that there was kind of two types of people, the ones that gave up and probably died, and then these people that held on to hope and continued to live and engage in life. And he speaks about, I mean, he's like an existential therapy person, but he speaks about making meaning and purpose out of this mess is something that is really, it's really hard to do and really important. Can I see something happen? Can you share with me what's going on for you?
Yeah, those are just good words.
Here's, you know, I think we were talking about this when we were talking about the body keeps the score, is even in reading that book on trauma, it is a slow, really kind of like heavy go all the way through the book to get to the part where it's like healing and recovery. And to know that, like, if you or any of you are at a place where it's like, oh, this is problematic in my life, that that actually is not the end. I think that sometimes I will never like lead someone on to believe something that they, that's not actually true. I think it does take a lot of time. You know, it takes a lot of time to, and even like grieving, to get back to a place of fullness, but like to not lose heart and to not lose hope. And even I think that, you know, we were talking about the story of Elijah. Is it Elijah or Elisha? I think it's Elijah, where he is like, he's just done this big thing and then Jezebel threatens his life. He actually travels 40 miles to sit under a tree by himself and is kind of suicidal, I would say, in despair. And like God shows up for him there. But what's always ironic about that story is God tells him to go right back to the place that he was. And there's like that journey seems like it wasn't needed. But I think that God did something in his life to minister and nourish his soul and to show up with who he is to then like continue forward in that. But I think that sometimes it's like the sitting under the tree is not actually like the end in some ways. I really appreciate your just like maybe not so much in words, but in like sharing.
I'm actually going to speak about my time working in the community mental health, just because I did provide more supervision of other staff. So I was really big on showing appreciation to my staff for all of the things that they did and for acknowledging things that happened in their lives outside of work. So if someone got married or there was a birthday, I was probably the first person who was saying, okay, let's get them a card, let's decorate their office door, let's say thank you to them for the work that they're doing. So that felt really important to me. I also checked in pretty regularly with my staff and asked them about their sense of burnout and when do they need to take a vacation and are they working over 40 hours in the work week, because I had lots of high achievers who that was the case. And then I think I also worked with one staff who struggled a lot with emotional boundaries. And so helping her to pivot to helping her recognize what are the things that are coming up because of her and what are the things that are coming up because of that client that they're working with, and helping her to separate some of that a little bit, because she carried a lot of, she struggled more with enmeshment in terms of her emotions with clients. So I did most of it through my supervision, I would say.
You know, I think that that is something that, like, because I've experienced such a deprivation and almost what felt like, oh, this place feels like it's taking advantage of me. and kind of sucking me dry. I love that nonprofit. Mm-hmm. I also want to be very real with my experience. Mm-hmm. It's one of the best jobs I've ever had. Mm-hmm. And I've worked a lot of weird different jobs. But to kind of start to filter through that maybe it's you first. Mm-hmm. That, you know, something that I always try to filter through, like whenever we talk about things, I think at the office is mm-hmm. that I actually believe that us being at our fullness is beneficial for the other people. Mm-hmm. So if you have to like tune out and do you first or call each other, if you start to notice things within each other's mm-hmm. lives, hey man, I think that like you need to go like walk the block or like just take the afternoon, you know, like in my mind, not a lot of things are very urgent. Mm-hmm. And if there's like blood and guts urgent, I'm not the person you should call.
Yes.
Actually.
Yes.
So just starting to filter through what actually is a crisis. There are very rarely things that are actually a crisis that couldn't wait a day. Mm-hmm. And I think that even for like some of the students that are always coming at you, like what would it look like to maybe not that you want to be withholding of yourself, but to delay a response so that you can actually respond well and out of fullness, but then also that they would also learn to hold some of this stuff in a way that would increase their tolerance to grow up and do life on their own. But to start to like, as a team, to start to be like, okay, maybe it's us as a staff team first, how do we care for each other? Mm-hmm. Then maybe it's how do we care for our mentors in a way that it's like, hey, like, here's the thing, a scarcity mentality gets into this and it's like, if I don't show up, nothing will. Mm-hmm. And any way you start to notice scarcity mentality, you have to come against it mm-hmm. with like, no, I think that there is enough to go around and maybe we don't have to be mm-hmm. so depleted mm-hmm. Or hold on to things so tightly. Because mm-hmm. if you think, oh, if I don't respond to somebody, that might, nobody will, and that might not be it. And like, honestly, with the population you serve, it could actually have very serious consequences, probably. But to also like trust that they're is more than just you out there, that you mm-hmm. actually are not God in mm-hmm. people's lives. Mm-hmm. You know, Pam and I would really like to, mm-hmm. as we end our time, knowing that this would probably be something that's like, oh, this is core to like who I am. We just mm-hmm. want to finish by praying for you guys. Mm-hmm. And to kind of, you know, wrap up and let you guys get on with the yeah. doing, the human doing. So, yeah. But,
yeah. Do you want to start and we'll close mm-hmm. this out?
Okay.
Father, thank you so much for your presence and for your kindness to the folks that sit here in this room and for those that they support and that they lead. And Father, I can't quite name it. I feel some level of heaviness and just a longing for hope. And I pray, God, that you would provide that to those in this room who need to feel that today, Lord. Father, that we would believe, there's this poem that says, I believe in the sun even when it's not shining. I believe in love even when I don't feel it. And I believe in God even when I feel like you may be silent. Father, we ask for your hope and for your restoration and for your sense that we are not going to be in this place forever.
Father, I always sit in these moments with this group of people, and I'm truly inspired mm. by the care and intentionality that they're trying to do some of these things in their life. And even in this moment, I'm praising you that your word says that what you offer us is rest mm. and that you invite us into rest. And Father, even realizing that there's something about our weariness that points us back to you, mm. that that we aren't God and that we're limited, tired human beings that need to sleep every day and need to eat. And I just pray that you would actually minister to us through those really ordinary rhythms of taking care of ourselves, mm-hmm. that like when we eat, that we would just reflect on the fact that you have provided and that you're nourishing even our bodies as we try to do this work that you've given each one of us. So I thank you that you say it's not a burden, it's not a weariness, but it's a rest if you meet us in that place. I also lift up Brooke and her tears, and in her, I would even say, just the heart, that when words fail, that there is something at work in there. And just for everybody, whether they showed it externally or not, mm-hmm. that you, as our great physician, as our healer, and all that you've done through your son, that you would actually meet every single one of them in a place and continue to do a work of healing in all of our lives. It's a disparity, Father, that in this life it won't be perfect and it won't be totally done, but that we look forward and hope to when your son will come back. Mm-hmm. And when we can't make sense of the atrocities that happen to us in life now, that we would look forward and hope, mm-hmm. knowing that that your son is coming back, and that actually means a great deal for us. But in the meantime, heal us where we stand so we can continue to do your kingdom work.
Yes,
and meet people in their pain, and continue for ourselves to be pointed to you and what you've done, but also for the people that we work with. It's in your name, Father. It's in your name, Jesus, that we proclaim these things to be true and pray in thankfulness and say amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.